I'm not sure about you, but if anyone is going to be target of this message, it's going to be me. It may speak to you as well, don't worry. But particularly, I believe it will target me. And it's my desire that I will receive it humbly. Do you know whom God will look at? Those who tremble at His word. As you pray, God's people, are we willing to tremble His word? Are we willing to obey? Our obedience will begin to punish every disobedience. That's what we have read. That's warfare. It is a conflict. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your discipline too. Because whom you make your son, your discipline. We thank you for every little bit of discipline that you apply to us. We'll give you the glory for that. In Jesus' name. If this message will target anyone, it'll target me. I hope it will target anyone else. The very title of this message is challenging. I'm talking about the economy of God. I'm not talking about the economy of human being. I'm not thinking in terms of human being. I'm thinking in terms of Scripture. It is scriptural. That is why I'm going to give you some examples. It's a simple message. But if, as we have read, if we can be fully obedient, God will begin to punish the disobedience of the people around us. If we can be fully obedient, God says in His word very clearly, before I go any further, let's read it in King James Version. We read it in New Translation, or Simple Translation. Let's see what King James Version says. Chapter 10 of 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. It's the Word of God. I want you to take heed to it. Time is running out, I tell you, my friend. There's going to be soon a time when there will be no decision made. There will be no time for decision making. It's going to be over. And I tell you, the tough time will come, and we need to be ready now. Not tomorrow. Not day after tomorrow. Tomorrow never comes. You know that. Let's read chapter, shall we start from verse 3? Let's read. It's a conflict. It's a warfare. If you decide today, if we decide today, because I'm including myself in it. If we decide today that I want to fully obey the Lord, it's going to be war. Enemy will take you as a target. You'll become a danger. He is scared. Scared of you? No. He's scared of the seed that is in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And he is scared of that seed. Because if that seed grows, if Christ is formed, if Christ increases in me, he is in you. He's in every born-again child of God. He comes as a seed. What's the name of the seed? Living and abiding Word of God. It's not written word. No. There is a great difference between written word and the Word of God. Written Word speaks about the living Word. Many people do not know the distinction, and they keep speaking the Word of God, the Word of God. I'm speaking the Word of God. No, sir. It's a written Word, and there's spoken Word, or there is the Word that is known. His name is Jesus. And He is sown in every child of God who is willing. In the soil of his heart, That written word is not sown, but the living word is sown, according to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. The living word causes us to be born again. If you're not growing, you are going. Going where? Highway. If it's not God's way, it is highway. My friend, if I'm not growing, I'm coming down. It's like a plant. The seed is a plant. If a plant does not grow, sooner or later, it will be dead. It will be dead. Christian life is a life of growth. If you are the same as you were last week, you are decreasing. You are diminishing. You are going down. Be aware. Be alert. If I'm not growing, if I'm the same as 6 months ago, something is wrong with me. Something is wrong. Either it is a wrong birth, or it is I'm just a religious fellow, and there is no life of Christ in me. If it is there, it is in seed form. I tell you, I'm speaking to myself and to you as well. It's my privilege. But my friend, in this kind of church, people don't stay long. If there's a million strong church and they're all babies, they're all immature, is God looking that kind of harvest? Is the harvest God is looking for? Is he not like every farmer and he's looking for a ripe harvest? A harvest that is mature. Majority of the Christians are immature. And I tell you, in the days to come, there is going to be a lot of deception. A lot of deception. There will be no repentance. There will be no problem with your trouble, with your tribulation. Jesus himself said, in the world ye shall have tribulation. But he said, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You can't overcome the world. He lives in you and he overcomes the world. Remember this. It is not me. I can't overcome. It's not my victory. It's his victory. It's not your resurrection life, my friend. It is his resurrection life. Make sure that you know and you use these terms wisely. It's not my resurrection. I'm resurrected. No, no, no. He is resurrected. I am living in his resurrection. When he died, I died. When he resurrected, I resurrected. Whose resurrection is it? His resurrection. Whose life I'm living? His life. People are afraid to explain this like that. For though we walk in the flesh, human being, flesh. Walking by the flesh is that we have got a flesh. Even Jesus said himself when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, flesh is weak. Spirit is willing. Spirit is ready. Why? Your spirit, Christ's spirit has come to live in that spirit, and that spirit is awesome. I tell you, if soul is not brought under subjugation, your spirit cannot do anything. I'll say it again. If your soul, that is your emotion, your mind, your intellect, is not under the hand of God, if it is not subjugated, then spirit is worthless. As far as you are concerned, it's not working in you. It's just a nominal Christian. And you can stay nominal Christian and end up in one of the realms. Maybe the realms of the least or outer darkness. But my friend, are we not willing to be overcomer? Bride is going to be overcomer. Bride is going to be overcomer. And according to the parable that Jesus gave, how many will be included in the bride? 50% at least. 50%, no more than that. Five were wise and five were the same thing they had, each and every one. They're all the part of the kingdom. Some people don't believe this. Let's read it, please. I just want to finish it. I want to come to those authorities, those people. The people, I didn't give you the title even, did I? You're quite all right and you're awake. The title is, according to the scripture, disobedience or partial, I should say properly, a partial disobedience equals to witchcraft. Disobedience. It is equal to disobedience and it's witchcraft. It becomes rebellion. Disobedience becomes rebellion and rebellion equals to witchcraft. So you're trying to tell me I'm witch? I'm not trying to tell you. You can read in the book of Samuel chapter 1 and verse 15. God says it. Rebellion is equal to witchcraft. So if someone is rebellion, will you go against that power that is trying to make that person rebellious? Or are you going to fight with the flesh? Fighting with the flesh is a losing battle. You lose the battle. Let's read verse 4, please. Verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. What are the carnal weapons? Carnal weapons are the weapons that are based on five senses. Your hearing and your seeing, your smelling, your tasting, and your touching. This is limited to that. If somebody cannot think further than that, he's a very poor Christian. Can you imagine? And I simply said, listen. I said, the history is his story. I said it, history is his story. Why? He was the first one who was mentioned as a redeemer of mankind. Where? Chapter 3 of Genesis, verse 15. The woman's seed. The woman's seed will crush the head. Who was this? Is he mentioned in history? I said, when he came in the history, history was divided into right in the middle. B.C., before Christ, and A.D. Anno Domini. Anno Domini. But do you know what they translate in our languages back in India? After the death of Christ. What a lie. Enemy is good at lying. And I tell you, he is succeeding awfully. He is succeeding in lying, and everybody accepts this lie after the death of Jesus. Nobody tells them, nobody bothers to see. These two words stands for two Latin words, and these two Latin words mean they are Anno Domini, and the meaning of this word is in the year of our Lord. I said, is he not in history? History is run by his calendar. You set dates all over the world. By whose authority? By the authority of Jesus. You may not believe in him. You may not accept him. This world is being run by him. Every atom he is holding by the word of his power. That's Jesus. But in the days to come, many will rise up. And they will disdain the authority of Christ. Will you fight with them? You know what I said on the radio? I said, Christian, don't even try to fight. He is all-powerful. Has he not said all power in heaven and earth is given to me? Is he not able to defend himself? He doesn't need your help. He doesn't need your help to defend you. Well, let's come back to I was a little bit gone off. For the weapon of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of the stronghold. Carry on, please. Let's read it. Casting down imaginations. Every inferior imagination must be cast down. Every imagination that rises its head above the knowledge of God, we say, bow down in the name of Jesus. He is the authority here, you are not. Casting down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Whatever is not against the knowledge of God, you have got the right to say bow down You will not stand. You have no legs to stand. I cut your legs in Jesus' name. You've got to use, it's not your authority. I tell you, he will speak, he will enable you to speak these things. Things that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God and bringing into captivity. We're soldiers. Imagine Emmanuel as our brother Emmanuel as standing on the Tefik vault, and he has got a whistle in his hand, and he is supposed to stop the people who are not driving properly. And someone is making mistake, and he is rebellious. He picks up the phone, and he takes the number of Theresa Mayer. Prime Minister, a man is disobeying. What shall I do? He said, we pay you to handle it all right. You have got the authority of Great Britain behind you. Take authority. Write his name. We will back you. He is disobedient. We will back you. My friend, we need to take the authority. But you see, there is power. We're not talking about power. You say, well, what is the difference between power and authority? Let me speak to you about this. Power is simply a robber goes to the bank with a shotgun, little shotgun in his hand, and he hides it and he shows it to the cashier and he says, can you see that? He said, yes. Whatever you have got, put in a bag and hand it over to me, or I'll shoot you. That's power. That is not, the soldier has got authority. But this man who is robbing the bank has got power. What is the power? That little handgun. Let's go to this, please. We're going from place to place, you know. I had a complaint from someone that you go from here to there, you know. I think I'm going to stick to it, you know. It's a challenge. I accept it. Casting down imagination and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Wake up, God's people. Time is going to come. Some of you will use this authority. Verse 6, please. Verse 6. And having in readiness to avenge all disobedience. Oh, so you are avenging, you are allowed to avenge it. He's living in you. Vengeance is mine, he says. And here it says, and having in readiness to revenge all disobedience. Oh, so that's easy. No, it's not easy. Read the next paragraph, next sentence. Read the next sentence, please. It's not easy. If you say it's easy, you think again. And having in readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Something somewhere has gone wrong. Somewhere I'm not disobedient. I'll go with the word of God. It doesn't matter what someone says. It's the word of God who is true. Let all men be liars, and let God be true. Let God be true and every man up. So how does it work? How do you punish a disobedience? That is troubling me. When I say, Lord, where do I trespass? Where I'm missing you? What is the problem? And most of the time, it's me, mine. Somewhere. Well, let's come to this. So it's a warfare. It's a warfare. Disobedience is equal. Every partial, I've said the word very wisely, please. Every partial obedience equals to disobedience. That's the title if you want to take it. How do you know? Well, I've heard from the scripture, you know. Let's go to Moses. I'm not going to read every one of them. Just listen to this. Just listen to this. Moses was a mighty deliverer, wasn't he? He was the man who was speaking to God face to face. He was a powerful man. And one of the qualities that he doesn't say, but God says, write it down. He wrote it, but when God says, write it, he doesn't have to question. He was a humble man. Moses was the meekest man in the world. But let's see what he is doing. He is uptight. He is angry. People have brought his temperature too high to hold on. Devil pressed the red button. I would say that. Devil pressed the red button, and he doesn't even honor God. He dishonors the people of God, and he says, "You rebellious people, shall we bring the water out of the rock?" That was disdaining the people of God. God didn't allow him. God didn't ask him even to hit it. He went to the rock and he says, "Shall we bring water out of the rock for you?" And in his anger, he lost his plot and he did hit twice. That rock was Christ. He was to be beaten only once. This man who walked with God, talked with God face to face, in anger, he broke what was eternal. Jesus was to be beaten only once, and it was all shadow. Bible says everything that happened to them was a... This rock was the shadow of Christ Jesus. He was to be beaten only once. He had did it before. He did it before. Now he was told, speak to the rock. He has been beaten, isn't he? He has been beaten. Anyone who is sick now, I would simply say, focus on that whipping post. Fix your gaze at the whipping post. What was whipping post? Where Jesus was lashed. One less 40 lashes. Every lash was for my healing. Will I trust or will I not trust? That's my decision. So first person that proves to me this partial, he obeyed. God said, go and speak to the rock. He went. But was it a partial obedience? He did obey. Oh, God's people, this is a very good example. That will be enough for you to remember, and do not expect that my partial obedience will please the Lord. It will not. It will not please. Let's come to Joshua quickly. I just want to remind you of these people, mighty men of God. Joshua replaced Moses. It was not an easy appointment. It was not an easy thing to come in the shoe of Moses. He was too big. But the Lord was with him, and he comes. He brings the people, they cross Jordan. And there is Jericho. And they understood that Jericho is not going to be won. But can you see the partial obedience of Joshua? He tries. Didn't ask God. Did he ask God when he sent two spies? No, he did not. It was his idea. It was his thinking. It was his way. Our ways are not God's way. Our thoughts are not God's thought. As the heaven is higher than the earth, so are his ways higher than our ways, and his thoughts higher than... Oh, my friend, he made a big mistake. But thank God he was corrected so beautifully. He sees the captain of the armies of God. And he goes to him and he asks him a question. With whom are you? With our enemy or with us? What he said, in other words, I will just paraphrase it. I'm not here to take sides. If I say it in a simple English, this was what the captain said. I am not here to take sides, I'm here to take control. I am here to take control. If he is not taking control, he's not going to do anything. I want him to take control of my thoughts. I want him to take control of every area of my life. There should be no place in my life that is not under his control. That is why partial obedience is equal to disobedience. Partially living for the Lord is living like someone about whom Jesus said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. You're not cold, you're not hot, you're lukewarm. And my friend, the church has become totally useless for some people. They don't even want to lick to them because they are complacent people, compromising people, people who are half-hearted, wishy-washy, lukewarm. Lukewarm Christian will not impact anyone. They will not impact anyone. They can deceive, but they can't impact anyone. God is not with them. They're like spittle. I'll spit you out of my mouth. You're not cold, you're not, either you are with him or you're against him. So Joshua, thank God, was corrected. But a little bit further, he saw great victory. I'm not going to go into, because you know how Jericho was won. It was planned by the captain of the army. Everything was done by him. Even strategy was given by him. Everything, they did exactly as he told them. There was a victory. They didn't have to fight. It just fell. And they just took hold of everything. But then AI comes. You know AI? I'm not talking about artificial intelligence. No, AI mean it was a city. It was a city. And they said, no problem. You don't need to ask God. One thing more. I want to ask you this question. Where is that place where God rebuked someone for praying and crying and wailing and weeping, putting dust in their head? Do you remember that place? Joshua, Achan, one of the people in the people of God, his name was Achan. He had disobeyed, and they didn't ask the Lord, what's the problem? They were crying and said, get up and find the one who has sinned. And they took him. Was there mercy shown? No. He was too dangerous to live. Achan, are you with me? Are you with me? Not listening to God means you are going to be in trouble. Don't you say that trouble is brought by the Lord. He disciplines, of course, me and every one of us. Praise the Lord. So again, partial obedience equals disobedience. Disobedience equals to rebellion. Rebellion is equal to witchcraft. Okay, shall we see someone else as well quickly, as the time is passing? Oh, I'm enjoying it. Praise God. Plan for the conquest of AI was by human being. Did it work? No. It was a defeat. Now they're crying. Lord, why did this happen to us? Why have you brought us here? And the Lord says, get up. And do what you need to do. Find out the person. Find out. It can be in my mind. It can be in my heart. It can be a sin. A man of God said, I particularly target one sin. He said, I've got the weakness. I judge. I know it's not your weakness because you don't judge anyone. But this judgmental spirit is a dangerous spirit. It's a dangerous spirit. And I tell you, God, make sure that you are judged too. If anyone, this man, you know, who heard my message, he said, I will never be the same again. I said, are you sure? He said, when someone, even a company of us, he's a leader. He said, a company of people sit down and we want to talk against someone, everybody chimes. Everybody has got to say something. You know, this kind of conversation looks very pleasant to their base nature. You know base nature? Flesh. Flesh loves it. You talk against someone, talk against a person, it's a flesh. My friend, let's go quickly further down. I'll talk about a very special man. His name was Saul. He was anointed by Samuel. Do you know what was his problem? He was a disobedient person. Everything he did, what God told him to do, it was a partial obedience. Have you noticed? I would recommend you to read his story and underline the things where he was partially obedient. I have obeyed the Lord. You know, when you talk about this, you know, in 1 Samuel, start reading from chapter 13 and chapter 14 and 15. When Samuel confronted him, "Have you obeyed the Lord?" He said, "Oh, of course. Bless you." He said, "Shut up." He said, "What do I hear?" Samuel was a tough prophet, I tell you. He said, "What do I hear?" He said, "I hear the cows, the sheep, oh, it's the people. Oh, they brought it for the Lord." He said, "Is God so interested in sacrifice?" Oh, no. Obedience. He is interested in obedience, my friend. So this was Joshua. No, I mean Saul. This was Saul. And he was a partially obedient man. Does God like it? No. I don't know whom shall I pick up in the New Testament, but I can pick up one person. I can pick up Peter. Peter and the partial disobedience was given to me in Luke chapter 5. Let's read it, please quickly. We have got a few minutes. It was a partial obedience. It was obedience, but partial. And many people don't take note. And some of the translation have made a mistake in this. Because we are going to go to King James, it will be okay. Luke chapter 5, starting from verse 1. Listen carefully. This was a partial obedience. Partial obedience, we have decided, and we have seen some example, is equal to disobedience. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him, Jesus, to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, okay, and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Okay, let's read it. And he entered into one of the ship, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now listen carefully where the partial obedience comes. Now when he had left speaking, when he finished speaking, he said unto Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets." In many translations, they have made a mischievous mistake. It's net. If you want to check it out, you can check it out. They couldn't understand what is happening here. It's a big mistake here. Now, when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, "I want to pay you. Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch, for a draught." Okay, what did he say? And Simon answering, said unto him, "Master, we have toiled all night. You're not a fisherman, you're a carpenter. We are fishermen, we know better than you do. We have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, in spite of all this, I don't recognize you, fisherman. I don't know. I don't understand how can you make something good and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net." That is the proper translation of the Greek. You will see many translations. They put nets. He was partially obedient. What happens then? What happens? And when they had this done, that's a very good translation, isn't it? When they have done this, it's a different translation, but it was written for ordinary people. He wanted the plowman to read it, the one who did this translation. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fish, and their net, there was only one net, it was a partial obedience, only one net. Jesus said, nets. And their net break. Okay? Let's read this. And they beckon unto their partners. Now it's too late. They didn't obey before. Which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, and so that they began to sink. Then the reaction of Simon shows us he had had partial obedience. When Simon saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees and said, depart from me. Why depart from me? I'm not an obedient man. For I am a sinful man. You said, I would simply say, you said nets, and I put just net. I didn't believe it. This way. And lastly, I would simply say, Ananias and Sapphira, in Acts of the Apostle, sold some land. They were supposed to give all the money there, deceiving the church, and they put whatever they like. It was the Spirit of God alive and present. Peter said, is it the money you got? Did you bring it all? And yes. He said, why did you decide to deceive the Holy Spirit? What was the tragedy? Husband and wife both dead. You say, why doesn't it happen today? There's no presence of God. Why the two sons of Aaron died at the spot? There was the presence of God. Why does it not happen today? People deceive God and money, left and right hand. Nothing happens. Of course, they may suffer. But I tell you one thing, partial obedience in every area of our lives equals to disobedience. Who says? I've given you enough example for that. Partial obedience will not be rewarded. No, sir. It will be punished. You have seen it in every authority I've spoken. Let's stand in the presence of the living God. Let's pray that we will not partially obedient to the word of God. We will not pick and choose. Time is coming. Everything that you have and is not good, it will begin to multiply. If you have sin, if I've got sin, and I don't want to forsake sinning, it will begin to multiply. If you're righteous and you want to live righteously, that will multiply too. God's people, don't think I've targeted you. I've targeted myself. Now I'm the target. I need to be fully obedient. Partial obedience won't do. It will not work. God will not be pleased with this. Wishy-washy life, half-hearted living with Christ can be shame to our Lord. It can bring him dishonor. Let's decide. At least you can decide. If you decide, the Holy Spirit will take over. We'll let him do it. Lord, I want to live that partial obedient life, fully obedient. When my obedience is fully operational, the disobedience around me will begin to be punished. That's the simple formula. This is scriptural. You read it in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. It's not my idea. Lift up your hand to the Lord. Let's lift up our hands to the Lord. And let's speak to him. Lord Jesus, I come to you personally because you're the Lord. You are the King of Kings. Thank you for coming in my heart. I thank you You're living in me. Enable me, Holy Spirit. I want to trust in you to fully obey my Lord. I don't want to exercise. I don't want to entertain partial obedience. I want to be fully obedient to the Lord, to the glory of God. In Jesus' name, amen.